name is Ben Rosen. I served in the 8th Army Air Force, 14th Recon Division. My rank at the end of the war was Tech Sergeant, and my assigned duty, ironically, was motion picture photographer, aerial motion picture photographer. The duty of a aerial motion picture photographer was to fly over enemy territory, photograph desirable targets, bring them back to base where the rolls of film were processed, and it was sent to the appropriate divisions as an assist in bombarding these targets. The irony was that I was then assigned to an airplane, to a base for airplanes, which were P-38s. They were one-man ships. There was no room for a second person, such as I, who was supposed to do photography. The cameras were automatic, and they were in the plane. They were built into the plane. That's a typical snafu situation of our beloved Army.
Go.
My service to the country, my dear, was rather obscure. Because my assignment was such that it couldn't be fulfilled, in a sense, the chief officers of the base really didn't know what to do with me. So as a result, I had a lot of spare time. This service to the country, to address that more directly, we were expecting, this was in 1944, my reference was to the 1944, there was an expected Nazi invasion into England. I was stationed just a few miles outside of Oxford, and we were daily expecting an invasion when Hitler, in his eternal wisdom, turned to Russia, thank God. Beyond that, we had a lot of spare time. And we had a better time than a lot of guys who actually faced action on the front. I felt meaningful was toward the end of the war in 45, after the war ended, except for Japan. And when that happened, we had time on our hands. And it was in that time that my friend Salamita and Adams and Jensen and I got together and decided to offer the 1,500 men on the base educational opportunities. I established an art class, and models came in from Oxford. Adams was an English professor, and he ran classes in English. Salamita was an architect, and I knew him at Pratt before the war. he offered architectural design and drafting. Jensen was a political scientist and expert on Russia. And he gave classes in that connection. So it was very successful because the classes were full, especially mine, when some of the GIs found out that there were nude models posing in the art class. So we had a little trouble picking times out. Otherwise, it was very successful. During the spare time, another thing we did, Solomita and I and Adams and Johnson together, at the end of the war, discussed the fate of some, I believe there were about 1,500 air bases in England. There would soon be a couple million English servicemen returning, and housing, which was acute before the war, would become critical. Solomita and I, with the help of the other gentleman, decided that the air bases had transportation, roads, there was a workspace in the form of the large, not the airport, but the large air building, the word eludes me. And there were many of the Nissen huts there. Now, the Nissen huts, we thought, could be easily and inexpensively converted quickly and could become temporary housing for the huge number of returning soldiers. And so we set to it. We had about 2.5 months Adams drew up some policy approaches. Jensen set up a political structure for the base, like a village. Solomita and I used the basic Nissen huts and adapted them, making them very comfortable and living, having comfortable living space for individual, a couple, or a very small family. And this, as we were working on this, the base commanders and so on became interested in it. And they contacted Anurin Bevan, who at that point was the health minister in England. And he became very interested in it and asked to see it when it was, as soon as we could present it. And then, what do you know, Churchill became interested in it. And we got very excited by that. Except that at the last minute, Churchill had to get on a battleship and couldn't attend. The two of us, Solomita and I, he drew up plans, I drew up an overall presentation and a rationale on what we were doing and how it would work. And we went off to London and presented it to the health department, which was the department in charge of housing in England at that time. We made the presentation. The English are delightful people. The English, I found, can review a recommendation and say no and make it sound like yes. They were very charming. First of all, they were very highly gratified at what we were doing. They were touched by that. then they loved the plan and the way the thing was hung together. However, the Labor Department had just at that point taken over, and they were concerned that someone else, not the Labor Department, was coming up with an idea to solve a very serious problem. Therefore, they gave us a thank you, but no thank you. I have the letter among my papers at Duke University. It's a very charming letter. And when we got back to the States, the architectural forum ran about 6 pages on the study. That was about the extent of my service. I was extremely fortunate in not having to suffer through what so many of my colleagues had, a terrible situation in earlier in the invasion and then in this land slogging army procedures near the end of the war. So that pretty much wrapped it up. We were, of course, delighted to get out of the army at the end of it. We missed being shipped off to Japan by 3 days before we were going to go to Japan was Hiroshima. So there was no place for us to go but home and get demobbed. It's in looking back that there are some bittersweet memories that, of course, will stay with us our entire lives. And I think that would cover my comments for an unexpected